Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sophie Briggs and the Magic Thief by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Em Eldridge. Chapter 1.
Will you please pass the present, Sissy?
Sophie Briggs smiled at our little sister Amelia and ruffled her hair.
Of course, Mills.
Sophie dug under the rainbow-lit Christmas tree and handed her several packages wrapped in hot pink holographic wrapping paper.
There's no mistaking who those are meant for,
Walter Briggs grumbled, brushing hot pink glitter off the legs of his plaid and holly Christmas pajamas. The set matched everyone in the room. Marcus, Sophie's boyfriend, also had been given a pair, which he wore out of respect for Sophie's family, rather than a desire to be seen in a shirt that read Happy Holly Days. These are yours, Sophie. Joyce passed her a bundle of purple presents.
Oh, and don't forget the blue ones,
Millie hollered, diving under the tree. She emerged from under the brightly lit pine foliage with three perfectly wrapped blue gifts.
These are for you, Marcus.
Oh my gosh,
Marcus gasped, his eyes widening as Millie set the gifts next to him.
You guys didn't have to.
Oh, it was nothing, Joyce Briggs scolded. You're part of the family now anyway. You opened those, she winked at him.
Yes, ma'am.
Marcus blinked moisture from his eyes. Sophie elbowed him, smiling broadly.
You ready to open? She asked him.
Let's go!
Millie yelled, tearing into her hot pink wrapping paper. Sophie and Marcus followed suit, and soon the Briggs living room floor was strewn with shiny bits of paper and lengths of glittering ribbon. Joyce and Walter watched from the couch, smiling as they grasped warm cups of coffee.
This is my favorite band,
Marcus gushed, holding a new black hoodie with Young and Deathless emblazoned on the front.
Thank you so much. How did you know?
A little bird told us.
Walter winked at Sophie. She smiled back, then lifted one of her gifts, a new white silk blouse.
To replace the one you ruined with coffee last year, Joyce chuckled.
Sophie and Marcus exchanged amused glances.
Thanks, Mom.
Sophie rolled her eyes.
I'll try not to ruin this one.
A unicorn!
Millie cried, snuggling a glowing stuffed animal.
I love it!
Aren't you getting too old for plushies? Sophie teased.
Millie stuck her tongue out at Sophie.
Hey, mind your own beeswax.
Sophie opened her next gift, one that looked surprisingly similar to Marcus's. It was a small, hardcover book with an ornate gold flourish on the front, but no title.
What is this? Sophie asked, turning it over in her hands to look at the back, which was similarly blank.
Marcus, too, examined his book, glancing at the blank spine in confusion.
Look inside, Joyce urged. You'll see.
Marcus and Sophie peeked at each other, then opened their books. On the first page of Sophie's book, a photo of Sophie, Millie, and Marcus at the pool filled most of the space. Under the photo was the title, The School of Roots and Vines, Fun and Adventures from Year One.
Wow,
Marcus murmured. Sophie turned the page in her book and smiled. All the pictures she'd sent her parents throughout her first two semesters were in this book, compiled into fun spreads and layouts. There were several pictures Sophie hadn't taken, official school photos from the trials, and various class activities like mosaics and life fundamentals. She was thrilled to see a photo of her and Charlotte working together on the caterpillars with Reggie, as well as one of her and Roscoe walking down the path together.
It's almost like a scrapbook.
She grinned as she flipped through page after page. She saw the first picture she'd ever taken with her roommates in the dorms before they'd run off to explore everything.
Oh my gosh,
Marcus laughed.
Is that what I think it is?
He pointed at a photo Sophie hadn't been able to make out, but when she looked closer, she rolled her eyes. There she was, hugging Thicket Hall. It was the photo Olivia had taken and teased her about. She was glad to see it in her album. Her bond with the massive oak had been forged deeply in her first semester, and she'd barely begun to understand her psionic gift when that photo was taken.
Sorry, I shouldn't have laughed at you for that. That was back before, you know,
Marcus explained. Oh, I know, Sophie snarked. Back when you were a jerk and helped Olivia tease me about that.
Oh, Marcus, surely you didn't tease our Sophie for tree hugging,
Walter contended, although he wore a mischievous grin.
Seeing as you can talk to Thicket Hall now, too.
Marcus's cheeks turned red.
Well, sir?
Walter gave a good-natured laugh and shook Marcus's shoulder.
You know I'm only messing with you.
Our books are different. Sophie glanced at Marcus's book. His photos consisted of the ones he and Sophie had taken together over the summer, as well as pictures with all their friends, the more recent ones from the fall festival and homecoming also. Mine only go through the first two semesters. We wanted to make yours chronological, like homemade yearbooks. You'll get photos from this past semester in the next book, Joyce explained. Sophie grinned and looked over Marcus's shoulder at his book. I'll get a sneak peek if I look at yours, though.
I heard the performance at the band contest was great.
Walter nodded at a photo of Marcus under the pavilion lights with his guitar.
Shame we couldn't be there to hear it.
Yeah, Millie pouted. I had to go to Grandma's the next day, so I couldn't come.
Sophie and Marcus both chuckled. You would have loved it, Mills. I'm kind of jealous you went to Grandma's without me, Sophie professed.
I'm surprised your father let you come back to school for that, Marcus, but I'm glad he did.
Sophie says the music did worlds of good for you, Joyce noted. Marcus froze halfway through turning the page, his gray eyes downcast.
Well, you see, he sighed. Dad wasn't given much choice. Headmistress Kay strong-armed him. If she hadn't, I guess I'd still be brainwashed somewhere.
Walter shook his head.
Sophie told us the whole story, son. You were fighting your way through that magic before she figured out the clues. I reckon you'd have come out of it sooner rather than later.
I don't understand why your father didn't see what was going on, Joyce pressed. How could he keep sending you back to those criminals? Marcus looked at her meaningfully.
With all due respect, Mrs. Briggs, you don't know my father. You don't understand how badly he wanted me to succeed.
Marcus made air quotes.
He wanted me in that internship, where I could be up close and personal with the top dogs in the biz. He wanted me to make a lot of money and be somebody he could talk about with pride.
Marcus glowered at the floor as he continued.
Not some loser who tried and failed to kill Thicket Hall. Not some kid who decided friends were more important than winning and made him look bad in front of his coworkers. No, that wasn't good enough for him.
He hugged his arms as he flipped his long white hair from his eyes.
Whatever, I don't care what he thinks about me. As long as I have my self-respect, I have everything I need.
Joyce gazed at him sadly, then leaned over and brushed Marcus's hair off his face.
You deserve much more than self-respect, Marcus. I'm so sorry you've had to pick yourself up in this way.
It shouldn't be any young person's job to do what their parents should have done, she avowed.
You figured out that truth on your own, which shows what a tremendous character you have,
Walter added, giving Marcus a twinkling half-smile. A smile Sophie only saw him give when he was having a heart-to-heart with her or Millie. Marcus laughed through his nose.
I wouldn't say I figured it out all on my own, sir.
He glanced at Sophie with a grin.
I had help from your older daughter and her friends.
Sophie smiled back at him. Don't shortchange yourself. You had to do many hard things to do the right thing. Marcus's smile faded, and he sighed.
I hope it's worth it in the end.
It will be. Millie grabbed his hand. You have us now, and all your friends. And Thicket Hall is your friend. How cool is that?
Everyone laughed. Later that night, Marcus and Sophie shuffled onto the front porch, bundled in blankets, with hot chocolates in hand.
Not as cold as I thought it would be,
Marcus observed as he settled onto the porch swing. He wiggled his toes, warm inside the fluffy black socks Sophie's parents had given him. You know how it is here, Sophie replied, sitting next to him. We'll get all our snowstorms in March, right before Easter. Christmas will be in the 50s and cloudy like it was today. Marcus shook his head and sipped the hot cocoa with his eyes closed. Sophie's mom had made it on the stovetop, and he'd never tasted anything so creamy and delicious. It rivaled the school's famous chocolate coffee.
Look,
Sophie pointed at the sky. Marcus ducked his head so he saw where she pointed, smiling as bright twin stars peeked out from the darkness.
It's us,
he chuckled.
Which one do you want to be, the left or the right one?
Sophie grinned smugly, then pulled out her phone and tapped her sky app.
I'll have you know, Castor is the right-hand star and Pollux is the left.
All right, Janet,
Marcus teased, nudging her arm.
What else do you know?
Sophie squinted at the app, then lifted her phone overhead. There's a nebula in Orion that we can see if I grab Dad's binoculars. I gotta remember where it is.
What, where the nebula is, or your dad's binoculars?
Marcus asked. Both, Sophie laughed. She tapped a quick message on her phone, then stepped off the porch to look overhead. Marcus followed her. Orion stood out against the dark sky, with its three bright stars in a line. A super bright blue-white star shone farther down, and he pointed it out.
What's that one? Looks like a planet.
I think that's Sirius. Sophie aimed her phone to confirm. Yep, the brightest star in the winter sky. The front door opened behind them.
Quit texting me in my own house,
Walter grumbled, shuffling down the stairs to hand Sophie the binoculars. It worked, didn't it? Sophie scoffed. And I didn't have to yell. Walter ruffled Sophie's hair wordlessly, did the same to Marcus, and traipsed back up the porch steps. Thanks, Dad, love you, Sophie proclaimed. Walter mumbled as he disappeared back inside the house. Sophie chuckled and shook her head when Marcus glanced at her. Such a grouchy dad. She peered through the binoculars, then pulled them away from her eyes, frowning. I forgot, they have to come to the outside temperature, otherwise they fog up. Marcus snorted.
Everything looks like a nebula when your lenses are fogged, I guess.
Yep. Sophie's smile faded, and Marcus saw that she was hugging her arms nervously. She glanced at her phone, then bit her lip. Do you think? She flicked through her messages, stopping on Dorothy's name and the message she'd sent them at the beginning of winter break. I wonder where they are, if they know we're here, if they're planning anything. Marcus stepped closer to Sophie, resting his hand on her shoulder. He had to admit he was worried too. Connor and Darla had escaped from the guards at the hospital. They could be anywhere, plotting their next move, and waiting for Marcus and Sophie to be vulnerable again. But after Headmistress Case's bad press campaign, it was unlikely they'd get away with any more stunts. Everyone knew what they looked like. Also, the EA was on its toes, putting out tons of cleanup journalism to cover their tracks and maintain their good rep among the non-magical community. Gregory Templeton had also publicly turned against his wife, a move Marcus was sure was made in desperation, rather than contrition for Darla's and Connor's crimes at his behest.
They probably know exactly where we are,
Marcus opined after a moment.
And you know what? That's fine. They can't do anything about it. There's no way they'd risk showing their faces anywhere near us.
Marcus smiled reassuringly as Sophie glanced at him.
Trust me, it'll be a long time before we see their faces again. If we ever do.
Marcus felt her turbulent emotions spinning under the surface of her magic. She wasn't convinced. He wasn't either. But he wouldn't let those criminals steal any more joy from him or the ones he loved. Especially not on Christmas night. Marcus pulled her into a hug, wrapping her in his blanket in the process.
It's all gonna be fine.
He breathed deeply as her warmth enveloped him. Sophie buried her cold nose into his chest and sighed. I know, you're right. I simply can't help but worry. When they took Millie. Her voice trailed off, and she rested her head against him. I can't let something like that happen again.
We won't, Marcus stated firmly. As long as we're together and have our friends and each other, they'll never be able to take us down.
Sophie looked at him with a genuine smile and nodded. Marcus smiled back, glad he was able to lift her spirits, at least a small amount. He still felt her doubt, but hope was rising in her, and the sparkle had come back to her big brown eyes. Let's find that nebula, shall we? Sophie asked, then stood on her toes and kissed him. Marcus grinned, unable to help himself, as she stepped away with a sly smile and aimed her binoculars at the heavens. Chapter 2. A few days passed, and soon the new year was upon them. New Year's Eve dawned bitterly cold, but clear and bright. Sophie, still bundled under her blankets, opened one eye as the door to her room creaked open.
Soph, Marcus whispered to her from the doorway. Are you awake?
I am now, she grumbled, rolling over to check her phone for the time. Marcus, it's 7 a.m. What in the world?
Check your email,
he advised. There was excitement in his voice and his magic. Sophie sat up, rubbing her eyes, and grabbed her blanket to keep it from sliding off her shoulders. Marcus sat on her desk chair, eagerly waiting as she unlocked her phone and scrolled through her email messages. A new message from Headmistress Case caught her eye, with the subject line of study abroad opportunity. Sophie blinked, then glanced at Marcus. Is it the study abroad thing?
Yeah, go on, open it.
He made shooing motions with his hands. Sophie raised an eyebrow but opened the email. Sophie, I wanted to reach out and let you know that you, your mentee Lindsay Baudelaire, and several other students have been selected by the Committee for the National Elemental Skills Conference to study abroad in Colorado for 8 weeks this semester. Sophie's eyes widened. Colorado?
I know, right?
Marcus exclaimed. Sophie smiled and kept reading. You were selected based on your impressive performances at the Elemental Skills Trials, as well as the performances of your mentees. Of special interest to the committee was your and Marcus's ability to create elemental lightning. A special demonstrative lab has been set up for the two of you, with the official date to be determined upon your acceptance of the Study Abroad program invitation. The other student invitees have also been chosen to perform in labs. Please see the attached documents. You can print them out and discuss the details with your guardians before you arrive at the school on January 6th, when we will meet with all families involved to determine the next steps. Warmest regards and happy holidays, Headmistress Norma Case. This is so neat. Sophie scrolled down to the attachments. Looks like there are several forms here for our parents.
Since your parents are legally my guardians right now, I wonder how that will work,
Marcus queried, Sophie shrugged. I guess their signatures will work on your forms, too. If Mom and Dad let us go. Marcus's excitement dimmed.
Yeah. They may not be so willing to let you go after what happened.
Yeah. Sophie yawned, then stretched her back and arms. We'll have to tell them at breakfast, I guess, and see what they think.
I wonder who the other students are,
Marcus quizzed. He paused, grinning at Sophie, his eyes on her clothes.
My old hoodie makes a great pajama shirt, huh?
Sophie blushed and pulled her blankets around her arms. Oh, hush, it's freezing outside. Marcus laughed. An hour later, the scents of pancakes and coffee wafted through the house. Millie bounded into Sophie's room as she was swiping on mascara.
Sissy, Mom made waffles!
Sophie nearly poked herself with a mascara wand, then blinked hard. She sighed in frustration, then wetted a cotton swab with eye makeup remover. Mills, seriously, you gotta quit doing that.
Did I mess up your makeup again?
Millie came over and examined the products scattered over Sophie's vanity.
Sorry. I wish Dad would let me start buying makeup.
She grimaced, wrinkling her nose as she watched Sophie scrub off her smeared mascara.
He keeps saying I'm not old enough, but I'm almost 12.
Sophie patted her eye dry, then reapplied her mascara. You're 11 and a quarter, Sophie stated, earning a frustrated sigh from Millie. And you're already beautiful. You know Dad doesn't want to see you grow up so fast. She glanced at Millie in the mirror, and her sister smiled shyly. If you want, I'll ask him if we can do makeover night tonight, since we're staying up late anyway.
Oh, that would be so fun!
Millie jumped up and down.
I'll go ask him.
Sophie chuckled as her sister hurried off. Millie had grown so much, and she loved seeing her blossom into a bubbly preteen. Their time together was more precious since she'd rescued her from the Templeton's clutches last semester. Sophie frowned and blinked back tears. That had been a dark day, but she couldn't let herself dwell on it. Millie was safe, and so were Marcus and her friends. That was all that mattered. She got up and followed her sister to the dining room. Joyce was in the kitchen, working with the waffle maker. Hey, Soph, she called. Made you hot chocolate coffee. Not as good as the school's, but it's pretty darn good, if I do say so myself.
It's delicious,
Millie exclaimed, kicking her feet excitedly as she sat at the bar with her steaming mug. Sophie smiled and grabbed her purple mug from the counter. Thanks, Mom.
Where's Marcus? Walter asked.
He was at the table and had eggnog-flavored coffee. Sophie shrugged. Not sure. She set her coffee down and headed down the hall to peek into the guest room, which used to be her mother's office. She knocked. Marcus? No answer came, so she stepped inside and peered around. Marcus's phone, which was still on the nightstand, vibrated as she walked past, then lit up.
Please talk to me, son,
the message read. Sophie narrowed her eyes. She didn't want to pry, but couldn't help but notice who'd messaged him. His dad. Sophie paused with a sinking feeling in her chest. She knew Robert Jenkins had lost custody of his son for several months after he'd continued to put Marcus in harm's way during his internship. That was why Marcus was here for the holidays and not at his home, and it was a good reason. Still, Robert was begging for interaction with his son, so Marcus wasn't speaking to him. That made Sophie's heart ache. She sighed. She hadn't meant to invade Marcus's privacy. He wouldn't be angry since it was accidental, but Sophie didn't feel right carrying the burden of this new information. She turned to leave, but the ensuite bathroom door opened, sending an avalanche of steam pouring into the room. Marcus stepped out in black skinny jeans, drying his long white hair in a towel and humming. Sophie realized with a blush that he hadn't put on a shirt. Marcus froze when he caught sight of Sophie, and she jumped back.
Sorry, so sorry. Dad wondered where you were, so I...
Sophie caught herself admiring his muscle tone, much more defined than it had been over the summer, but still lanky and lean. Had he been working out? Marcus chuckled, and there was a smirk on his face.
Yeah, I know.
He ran his fingers through his damp hair with a shrug.
They had me doing physical training at the internship. I guess it wasn't all bad.
Sophie opened her mouth, then closed it.
I'll go now, she responded, her voice higher than usual.
Sissy, is everything okay? Millie asked from the doorway.
Yes, go!
Sophie hurried toward the door to shoo her sister away, but she'd seen Marcus and was staring at him wide-eyed.
Come on!
She towed Millie down the hall, rolling her eyes when she heard Marcus laughing.
Sophie, he's so handsome, Millie sighed. He looks like the pop stars in those magazines. You're so lucky.
Sophie hurriedly picked up her coffee and sipped it casually as her father looked over his newspaper at her.
What's going on?
Walter asked, one eyebrow raised.
Nothing, Dad, Sophie and Millie chorused.
Sophie kept her eyes averted as Marcus entered the kitchen. Millie giggled quietly.
There you are, dear.
Joy sat the last plate of waffles on the table.
Just in time.
This looks amazing, Mrs. Briggs,
Marcus insisted. He glanced at Sophie and Millie.
You ladies coming to eat?
Yeah,
Millie replied dreamily, taking her seat across from him at the table. Sophie continued to sip her coffee, determined not to look at Marcus. But she felt a familiar prickling in her mind.
Why are you so shy all of a sudden?
He asked in her mind.
I'm still the same person. I have a few more muscles, that's all.
His voice turned sweet, and Sophie felt the mischief in his emotions.
Don't you like it? Should I quit working out?
Sophie choked on her coffee. Are you all right, Sophie? Joyce peered at her in concern. You haven't had breakfast.
I'm fine, Mom.
Sophie sighed and joined her family at the table, but she noticed Marcus's triumphant smirk as she sat next to him.
I'll get you back for that, Sophie snarked, taking a bite of her waffle.
What did I do? You were the one who was poking around in my room, he replied innocently. I can't help it that you saw a Greek god or something, sheesh.
Sophie burst into laughter, nearly spitting out her waffle. Millie laughed too, while Marcus struggled to contain his amusement. Joyce and Walter looked on in confusion, glancing at each other warily. After Sophie controlled her laughter, she breathed deeply, elbowing Marcus for good measure as she pulled her phone from her pocket.
Mom? Dad?
She scrolled until she found Headmistress Case's email. We have exciting news. She handed her mother the phone, and Joyce and Walter read the email silently as Sophie waited, nibbling on her bacon and eggs.
What is it?
Millie craned her neck to see Sophie scream.
What's going on?
Seems your sister has been invited to go study in Colorado,
Walter conveyed.
Marcus too, added Joyce. Won't that be fun?
Millie gasped and stared at Sophie.
You're going to Colorado?
Only for 8 weeks, Sophie reassured her. And only if Mom and Dad say I can.
8 weeks? Millie squeaked. That's like a bajillion days.
Of course we want you to go, Sophie, Joyce asserted. This is an honor.
Her excited smile faded.
It's just that I worry.
I know, Mom. Sophie reached to take her phone back. I get it if you're not comfortable. Marcus kept his head down, but Sophie noticed how quickly he was eating. He was too polite to say anything, but he'd woken her up at the crack of dawn. He really wanted to go.
It's comforting that the headmistress seems to think this is great, but how do you two feel about it?
Walter asked. Marcus and Sophie glanced at each other, then at Joyce and Walter.
The idea sounds fun and exciting, Sophie answered. And honestly, it would be a nice change of pace to maybe get away from Louisville and the organization that's caused so much trouble for us the past year or so.
Marcus nodded.
I couldn't agree more.
Joyce looked thoughtful.
Do you know the other students who are coming with you?
The only ones we know for sure are our mentees, Marcus explained. That's Lindsay for Sophie and Hector for me. We're all pretty close already.
I would guess Simon, too, Sophie added. He placed first in the skills trials last semester. I think his mentee's name is Ian.
That means Headmistress Case is sending her best and brightest.
Walter winked. He nudged Joyce.
And the strongest students all together in a group will be able to hold out against whatever challenges they face. Right, hon?
Joyce smiled.
I suppose you're right.
She sighed and glanced at Walter.
Does this mean we are going to officially approve?
Sophie and Marcus waited, grinning, as Walter ate more eggs, chewing as he pretended to mull it over.
I reckon we are,
he affirmed at last.
But only if you're sure.
Yes!
Marcus and Sophie high-fived each other. Joyce shook her head.
Don't make me second-guess myself. They're all excited.
Millie stuck her tongue out at Sophie.
I'm so jealous.
Don't be jealous, Sophie told her with a grin.
Once you get into the school, I'm sure Headmistress Case will be sending you all over the place.
The day passed quickly, with a fun dinner out at Ned's Chicken and a trip to the supermarket for noisemakers, sparkling juice, and tons of snacks. Joyce made more hot cocoa on the stove, and as the evening passed, they played board games and listened to holiday music on the TV.
Not many people listen to Christmas music after Christmas, Marcus noted,
halfway through an intense session of checkers.
It's a family tradition, Joyce instructed, jumping one of his pieces.
We listen as long as they have it on.
Dang it,
Marcus snapped his fingers.
Got me again.
Yeah, Millie mumbled as Sophie brushed gloss onto her lips. Mom starts in November and doesn't stop until February.
Hold still, Sophie scolded, or you'll get this up your nose.
She finished with the gloss, and Millie batted her eyelashes, looking in the mirror Sophie gave her.
Looks good, sissy.
She puckered her lips, then ran over to Marcus.
What do you think?
Marcus chuckled.
I think you look pretty with or without makeup.
Good answer, Joyce responded, and Millie blushed.
Fiddle-faddle,
Walter grumped, but he forced a tired smile as Millie ran to his armchair.
Looks beautiful, sweetheart. Now take it off.
Dad!
Millie stomped away and plopped down on the couch. Sophie stood, stretching her legs, and noted the time.
Guys, 3 minutes till!
Oh, yay!
Millie leapt off the couch, and Sophie grabbed the sparkling juice and noisemakers from the kitchen counter. They turned the station on the TV to watch the ball drop, and by the time everyone had their glass filled with juice, 1 minute remained.
Oh, this is exciting!
Millie exclaimed, noisemaker at the ready. The countdown began, and as the excited buzz from the crowd at Times Square grew louder, so did Millie.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1!
Yay!
Millie went crazy with the noisemaker, sprinkling confetti all around. Joyce and Walter clinked their glasses and kissed each other.
Are you guys gonna kiss too?
Millie asked Sophie and Marcus with a sly grin.
Marcus
rubbed the back of his neck, glancing nervously at Joyce and Walter.
I don't know about that.
Oh, come on, Walter, it's New Year's, Joyce cajoled.
Go on, Walter sighed. I guess I'll allow it this once.
Sophie laughed, then leaned forward and gave Marcus a brief kiss. His cheeks reddened, and he smiled at her.
Happy New Year, Sophie declared.
Marcus pulled Sophie into a hug.
Happy New Year. All right, that's enough.
Walter shooed them off.
Go eat the snacks or something.
Dad, Sophie grumbled, rolling her eyes. She glanced back at Marcus and laughed. His face had gone beet red. Don't mind him. That's how all dads are with their daughters.
It's true, Joyce confirmed. My father was the same way. Didn't want me to go on a date until I was 40. It's a good thing he let up on that. Otherwise, I would have never married Walter.
Chapter 3. The next few days passed in a blur, and on the day before the first day of school, it snowed a few inches. Millie burst outside after breakfast, dragging Sophie and Marcus with her.
Let's build a snowman, she cried, scooping up snowballs with her mittens.
Too bad Leslie and Bree aren't here. They could build one super fast, Marcus asserted.
Yeah, Bree can do the ice thing with her hands, Sophie added.
That's so awesome! She's like a snow queen, Millie gushed.
She doesn't like it, though. Sophie patted the base of the snowman into more of a ball. Says it makes her hands cold.
I wouldn't care.
Millie skipped around the snowman while throwing snow in the air.
It would be so cool!
Sophie chuckled, rolling another massive snowball for the tummy, while Marcus found a couple of sticks for the arms. Why is it that when you ask to build a snowman, we build it while you watch? Sophie asked Millie.
Because it's fun, Millie said smugly, still skipping.
We're her minions, Marcus proclaimed,
smooshing the head snowball on top of the snowman.
Haven't you figured that out?
Millie giggled while Sophie rolled her eyes. After the snowman had been built and Marcus had complained about his frosty hands, they headed inside for cocoa and to finish packing their bags for school. Sophie packed her photo book to show her friends, her new silk blouse, and lots of cold weather gear for Colorado. Her phone buzzed in her pocket, and she pulled it out, smiling when she saw the names of her roommates and guy friends in the group text. Charlotte had texted.
Can't wait to see you guys tomorrow. We gotta have dinner together, of course.
Definitely, Sophie typed back, and there was a chorus of like-minded replies.
Are you taking this glittery nail polish? Millie asked, picking a bottle from Sophie's vanity.
Nah, you can keep it here, Sophie insisted. Don't touch the expensive bottles.
Which ones are those?
Sophie pointed to a small collection of colors near the back of the vanity with little gems on the tops.
Yeah, those do look fancy.
Sophie turned back to her desk to gather her school supplies, but paused when a figure appeared in the doorway. Marcus looked at her, and the storm in his gray eyes caught Sophie off guard.
What's up? She asked.
You look angry, Millie added, grabbing his hand. Are you okay?
The anger in Marcus's eyes calmed as he looked at Millie. He patted her hand.
I'm all right, don't worry. I just need to talk to Sophie for a second.
Millie nodded, but didn't move.
Alone,
Marcus added kindly.
Oh, right, sorry.
Millie chuckled nervously, then ducked out of the room. The storm in Marcus's emotions rushed back after Millie was gone.
What's going on? Sophie asked.
Marcus sighed and flopped into Sophie's desk chair with his arms crossed.
It's my dad, he growled. He wants to talk to me.
Sophie gave an understanding nod.
Why don't you? She asked.
Marcus glanced at her sharply.
Why would I want to talk to him after what he put me through last semester?
He huffed and shook his head.
He's lucky I don't block his number.
Marcus, Sophie sat on her bed. You know he'll eventually have custody of you again.
Not for long, Marcus growled. I'm turning 17 in October of this year. Pretty soon, I'll be an adult.
That's still a whole year, maybe more, that you'll be under his guardianship, Sophie reminded him gently. You think it would be helpful to try to have a cordial relationship with him?
Marcus stood and paced the floor.
How can you expect me to try to like the guy? You saw what he did to me. He clearly does not care about me, and is only sorry now because he was caught.
Sophie sighed. I don't expect you to like him. I'm simply saying he's your dad. He's the only one you have.
She stood and clasped Marcus's hands.
I don't want you to burn a bridge.
Marcus gazed at her sullenly, but his emotions grudgingly yielded. She had a point.
Marcus? Sophie's mom said from the doorway, startling them.
Joyce peeked in, her brow furrowed in concern.
I wanted to give you something, but if now isn't a good time.
Marcus looked pained and let go of Sophie's hands.
Sorry, Mrs. Briggs. I'm a little upset.
Nothing between us, Sophie added quickly, noting her mother's worried glance at her. Other stuff going on.
I'm so sorry. Joyce stepped into the room. You know, I happen to be a mother, and I also happen to sometimes give advice. Anything I can help with?
Marcus hesitated, unsure of what to say. But before Sophie answered for him, he sighed, and his shoulders slumped.
I'm having a hard time with my dad right now.
Joyce pressed a hand to her heart. She stepped fully into the room, then pushed the door until it was barely cracked open.
What's going on, honey? She asked.
Marcus glanced at her, and Sophie saw part of the storm in his eyes return full force. He wasn't sure he wanted to tell her, but something in him wanted to let it out.
It's totally fine if you'd rather not tell me details, Joyce soothed, gently touching his arm.
Marcus looked at her, then sighed again.
He texted me. He said he wanted to wish me luck going back to school. Said he missed me for the holidays.
Marcus looked at the floor as he spoke, shaking his head.
Sounds nice, but how do I know he means it? He said he wanted to call me. Well, I don't want to talk to him, you know?
Marcus shoved his hands in his pockets, scowling.
But part of me still wants to talk to him. It sounds real. He's never talked to me like this before.
He scoffed.
Another part of me thinks this is all a big act to soften me up, so I'll go along with whatever he wants when it's time for me to go back.
That is totally understandable, Joyce asserted. You've been hurt, and your trust is broken right now.
That is valid. She put a gentle hand on Marcus's back.
Maybe don't make a decision about it right now. Maybe give your heart more room to heal. Then come back and talk to him, when you're ready. You don't owe him a response right now, and he'll have to deal with that.
Sophie nodded. That was a much better idea than Sophie scolding Marcus for not wanting to talk to his dad. Joyce's gentleness had a positive effect on Marcus. He nodded, moisture clouding his eyes, while Joyce pulled him into a loose side hug.
Chin up, hun. It'll all work out, she proclaimed.
Marcus gave a half smile.
Thanks, Mrs. Briggs.
Joyce patted his back and moved quietly out. Dinner will be ready soon, she added quietly to Sophie before she left.
Thanks, Mom. Sophie gave her a grateful smile.
Anytime, sweetie. Marcus plopped back down on Sophie's desk chair after Joyce left.
I see where you get it, he said after a moment.
What do you mean? Sophie asked, gathering her school supplies.
Your understanding, and how nice you are to people, Marcus explained.
He glanced at the doorway, hugging his arms with a small smile.
You're a lot like your mom.
Sophie normally would have bristled at being compared to her parents. But she, too, had always admired her mother's ability to read a situation and give advice so naturally.
Thanks, she replied, and her gaze lingered meaningfully on his. After they'd packed, they sat to enjoy a final dinner around the Briggs family table. Joyce made her famous cocoa, and Walter had slow-cooked ribs dripping with delicious barbecue sauce all day, the scent filling the house and making their tummies rumble.
This is amazing, Marcus declared
with his mouth full of meat.
I'll have to teach you the secret recipe, Walter replied
with a wink. Why not give it to me, Dad? Sophie asked.
It only gets passed down to sons,
Walter divulged casually.
That means I either have to give him the recipe now, while we're his guardians, or wait until you two get married down the road.
Marcus and Sophie nearly choked on their barbecue. Millie hooted with laughter, and Walter and Joyce enjoyed a chuckle at their expense. After dinner, they settled on the couch with Coco to watch game shows. Sophie's eyes roamed the bookshelves next to the entertainment center and stopped on a book she'd seen hundreds of times but had never paid attention to. Its spine was decorated with gilded flourishes, and the cover was dark, like her photo album. Embossed gold letters provided the title, SRV 1989 to 1990. Dad, Sophie pointed at the book. Is that your yearbook?
Yeah,
Walter responded. He left the armchair and retrieved it, then set it on the coffee table.
Be prepared. Hair was a lot weirder back then.
Marcus chuckled, and Sophie opened the leather-like cover. Dozens of black and white photos decorated the first spread, and Sophie had to chuckle. Her dad hadn't been kidding about the hair. Most of the girls wore huge, elaborately sprayed hairstyles with fluffy bangs or scrunchies. With equally huge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.